Уважаемые коллеги,
dear colleagues, I hope that some more people will join us, but we have to start the lecture of our dear guest, president of the Turkish Gastroenterological Association, Professor Serhat Bor. So he was the initiator of epidemiological trials in Moscow, Moscow trials, Megre trials. He took part in the education of very many Russian researchers. Many of them are present here. So, Serhat, you are welcome.
Thanks. Did he or no? What did you say, Dimitri?
Very good about you.
If you say this in Turkish, that means bad. But okay, I'll get. And thank you very much for the invitation. A special thanks to Dimitri Bordin, my dear friend. And thank you for Reket Benckiser to help us to come together here and talk to you. That's a great honor. I've been here in my Facebook, even I have a picture doing like that. And the guy took the picture, I put it in my Facebook, it's there for years now. I remember this room very well. Here today we are going to talk about the reflux disease, and you will see the English there and the Russians over there. That's a perfect stuff. I'm gonna to talk about acid packet. This is a pretty new concept though, because for years we didn't get any new achievement for the mode of action, the pathogenesis of the reflux disease. Then this concept came out, the acid packet. Then we understood many things. I'm going to focus a little bit starting from epidemiology, then going to the some pathophysiology and the how to deal with this acid packet. This is a pretty new study. I appreciate the Russian friends. We performed this study together, and this is the first of all the epidemiology of reflux disease in the different parts of the world. This is the Turkish study, which just came out last week, World Journal of Gastro. This is the Russian Moscow study, I should call, and it just came out about 6 months ago. In this is of the esophagus. When we look at the in terms of the epidemiologic approach, one out of four adults have reflux disease. This is very common. Here we keep talking about IBD. It is very important, but how common is that? We think about the disease with the community perspectives as well. If it's too common, then it's also that much important. But when we look at the symptom patterns, we have a different symptom pattern for reflux disease according to the different geographical areas. For example, when we look at the American study, so pointer is not working well, but this is the American study here. You see Americans suffer from heartburn, not from regurgitation. All the Western world, this is the same. But when we move to the east, Russia in Moscow, that's echo, heartburn and acid regurgitation. But when we go to the southeast, including Turkey, regurgitation is the predominant symptom. Okay, who cares? What's the big deal with that? It is important, my friends, because what is the current medication for reflux disease? It's proton pump inhibitors. But we know PPIs are less effective for acid regurgitation. Then we need additional therapeutic modalities to deal with acid regurgitation. This is why it's good to learn your country's realities. Also, yeah, as I mentioned, this is the study from the Moscow. In Moscow, the prevalence of reflux disease is 23.6%. It's published in the disease of esophagus. We know what it is. And also, as I said, heartburn is the similar with acid regurgitation. When we look at the other data, for example, obese patients have more reflux. Interestingly enough, similar with Turkey, low-income population of Moscow has more reflux than the high-income population. General reflux accepts as a rich people disease, but this is not the case. as well as the aging. Yes, aging is a risk factor for all around the world, including Moscow study as well. Education, not that much important, not significantly different, but marital status is, yes, divorced people has a more tendency for having reflux disease. I don't know why. Dimitri, any idea about what? They should have less stress though. When we look at the medication, it's a little bit old study. When we asked this question, it was about 10 years ago. Now, at that time, acid inhibitors were not that common, but this is why we couldn't find any difference between the patients having reflux or the people without any reflux. Still, 72% versus 4.8%, there was a difference between groups, but it couldn't reach a significant point. But if you duplicate the study today, I strongly believe within this PPI world, we will see a huge difference between the patient with reflux disease versus non-reflux disease. How about the other symptoms? This is very important. When we look at the data in Moscow, there's an unbelievably high level of dyspepsia, 60% in patients with reflux disease. That means you guys have an overlap disease a lot. Dyspepsia plus reflux together. It's not that common in other part of the world. Also, nausea is very common, you see. Cough is common, and pharyngeal symptoms, those are all very common in Russian population, in patients with GERD disease. It is also common in other countries, but not as common as the Moscow population. Those are some characteristics of Moscow. How about the endoscopic findings? As far as I know, there is no Russian study. Look at the Barrett esophagus. That's a very important study and should be done. But when we look at the other countries, we are different, my friends. Don't get the Western countries as a general idea. About 10% of Western populations have Barrett disease. In Turkey, it's only 1%. I believe you guys don't have that common Barrett disease as well. Agree, Dimitri? It's not common. Do you see a lot of Barrett?
No, but we have a lot of patients because of...
Referral center. But I don't think in the community practice, GIs see many Barrett patients. Same in Turkey. You see the number is about 1% only. And two-thirds of our patients with reflux disease have normal endoscopies. We call them non-erosive reflux disease. This is a phenotype, and they will possibly never change their phenotype. If someone has a NERD, the lifetime span, this patient will go with NERD without turn to the erosive esophagitis or Barrett esophagus. Then, can I have some water, please? Water, thank you. Thank you. They take me a very great restaurant. Wow. Anyway, when we look at the erosive esophagitis data, only 1/3 of our patients have erosive esophagitis. When we look at the worldwide epidemiology, we just present our Turkish reflux guidelines. This is a result from there. We look at the East countries. Erosive esophagitis is only 8.8% compared to the 15% in the West. East always has less prevalent erosive esophagitis. This is also important for therapeutic purposes. If you have a patient with erosive esophagitis, you are supposed to go with continued PPI therapy. You cannot go with on-demand therapy. But with a patient NERD, you can go with on-demand therapy, either PPI or alginate or whatever. Then that's a different therapeutic approach as well. If you move a little bit to the physiopathology, the problem, we don't know why someone has the reflux disease. What is the initiator? No one knows. There are many pathogenetic factors, such as the, some noxious agents, reflux, pepsin, bile, pancreatic enzymes, whatever. We need a very strong esophageal epithelium to resist against the effect of different noxious agents. Okay, there are studies. We, for example, Bernstein test, we give them acid. They just smile. They don't feel the acid. They don't burn. Then actually, esophageal epithelium can resist such a harmful agent. Esophageal motility, always crucial, as well as the brain and the innervation. We have patients with 10 reflux episodes within 24 hours. In this population, you all have up to 75 reflux episodes within last 24 hours. Everybody has reflux. Everybody has reflux. If you have more than 75, then you may have some symptoms. But there are some patients, they have only 20 reflux episodes, very normal, but they feel 10 of those, for example. They have a very hypersensitive esophagus. We call it reflux hypersensitivity. I'm going to come back to that later on. All the therapeutic approach actually differs in such a group. This is the why, because they have central and peripheral hypersensitivity. Now let me come to the acid packet. Acid packet, an interesting thing. You know, when we eat something, the food actually accumulates here. And the food also stimulates the acid secretion. But the acid cannot mix up with the food. The acid comes top of the food and produce a layer. We call it acid packet. If reflux occurs, which reflux always occurs in the postprandial period, then the first this acid packet comes up and produces the symptoms, such as here. You see, there's a before and after, there's an acid packet on here. And this yellow part is the acid packet. Why it is significant? Because about thousands of years ago, humans were eating uncooked food, all kind of dirty stuff, bones, bugs. Then we used to need a protective barrier. If you eat a bug, it's good to pass it by an acid packet. Then the bug will die. Also, then we can digest the bones and others. This is what, under the regular conditions, we do not need actually acid when we need it the least while we are eating. But this is the main reason behind it. We need it because we need a protective layer on top of the food here. And following a meal, proximal stomach largely escapes from the buffering because the acid stays there for a long time and the cardiac becomes more acidic. And as I mentioned, this unbuffered acid packet localized very close to the esophagogastric junction and it moves upwards when the reflux occurs. Then this acid packet with pepsin, remember acid itself is not crucial, we need pepsin, they both affect the intercellular pathways and come into the cells from the basolateral side, produce an intracellular acidity, and then we have the reflux disease. As I mentioned, acid by itself, you can put a pH 2 acid for hours to the rabbit esophagus and nothing occurs. However, bile and pepsin, those are really, really noxious, very dangerous for the esophageal epithelium. Bile, one of the reasons of having Barrett and adenocarcinoma following that. Pepsin. There is a belief pepsin is inactive after pH 4, which is not the case. pH 4 is here, you see. Pepsin is still active up to pH 6.5. It's especially important in here, in laryngeal tissues, because in laryngeal tissues, it's very sensitive tissue. Laryngeal tissues does not have any protective mechanism against the acetylpepsin. This is why we have laryngopharyngeal reflux disease, which is very difficult to deal with. It's nearly impossible to treat it, that dose. Then how we have reflux disease? Is there any genetics? There's a very recent paper mentioned that they look at the whole genetic profile of reflux patients and their families. They claim some locus, but still we don't know. For Barrett, yes, there is a genetic predisposition. But for reflux disease, it's not clear. Aging is a risk, no one knows what. Then in our daily life, we do something very wrong. We eat Coke. We drink Coke, pH 2.5, osmolarity 2,800. I measure it by my hands. Then hypertonicity. If you eat Turkish baklava, you burn. How many of you have been in Turkey? Well, about half. Thank you. Many of you eat baklava, and then you start feeling, you know, the heartburn. That's for sure. Tea or coffee, it's very funny. We don't want to spill it on our hands, then we drink it. The poor esophagus burns, actually. Smoking is dangerous. I perform many studies with alcohol, rabbits, and humans. We show that alcohol is pretty harmful. But we have some studies combining alcohol and smoking on rabbits. Don't ask me how we give the smoking to the rabbits, that's the secret, but there is an additive effect for sure. The combination of smoking and alcohol is pretty bad, and some medications, and also some internal factors, as I mentioned, acid, bile, pepsin, pancreatic juice, whatever, they'll attack to the esophageal epithelium. What they did, they opened this intercellular pathways, okay, and the acetylpepsin comes deep into the deep tissues, deep layers of the tissue, they produce heartburn. And when they reach the neuromuscular junction, then we have other factors, such as esophagus shortens, we have hiatal hernia, LES defects, we have an open LES and others, then we have an irreversible disease. Reflux is a chronic disease. We cannot cure it in 80% of our patients. It's a pretty new publication. It's a new concept coming from Rome 4. I hate the Rome, if I tell the truth. I am the Turkish representative of Rome. I hate it. Anyway, don't tell them, please. Now, according to Rome 4, when we put a pH impedance catheter in someone, okay, if there is no esophagitis, after we put a pH impedance catheter, if we have pathologic amount of reflux within the esophagus, we call it non-erosive reflux disease, true NERD. But there are two subgroups. The one is reflux hypersensitivity. As I mentioned before, our patient has normal reflux episodes, but feels all of them. Very sensitive esophagus. How to deal with those? This is more important, functional heartburn. Those guys have very severe reflux symptoms. Endoscopy is normal. You put a pH probe, 24-hour pH is normal. He pressed 20 times to the button, I am burning, my doc. You look at the tracings. Not a single reflux episode, but they feel burning. Those are the patients we always fail. We just published a study show that half of those patients have either anxiety disorder or major depression. If you have a patient with resistance to your therapies, always think about the psychiatric medications, amitriptyline the first. I love it. Okay, let's come to the therapy. Eat less. This is the first message. This is, before I got the reflux surgery, though, this is before the surgery, I could eat delicious Turkish kebabs. Now I'm in trouble. How we manage those? There are different ways, medical therapies, allogeneics, prokinetics, H2 blockers, proton pump inhibitors, endoscopic therapies, if you have a question, I perform many spread tests and surgeries. Weight loss, that's the most important thing, weight loss, lose the weight. Obesity is the most crucial thing for the reflux disease, no matter what. Second, I strongly believe if you have a kid or your grandma or mother told you that, oh, eat slowly, right? Never eat so fast. You will have indigestion. You will have reflux disease. We wonder it. We look at the data. And my mother told me, and I told my mother, Mommy, sorry, you are wrong. Wrong. I mean, either you eat quickly or you eat slowly, it doesn't make any difference. But very interesting to what we learned. Look at this. Those are the acid reflux episodes. Immediately after the food, non-acid reflux episodes drop significantly, but still we have acid reflux episodes. Why? Because of acid packet. Even at the end of the 3 hours, we still have acid reflux episodes in patients or in normal human beings. Then to cover that acid reflux, this acid cap, we need some medications. One of those is alginate. This is it forms a, you see, this is the raft form. As far as I know, this is the only video endoscopy recorded in a patient who drank alginate. Alginate produces a raft form. Alginate is not an antacid at all. It has completely different mode of action. Okay, let's make this point clear. Alginate is not an antacid. There is antacid with alginate, but this antacid helps to facilitate to produce the raft formation. It's not because of the antacid effect. I'm talking about the pure alginate. Also, there are alginate plus antacids. You see in a retroversion, we see this formation of alginate in such a case. Also here you see the in vitro formation. We use half an hour after the food. Generally, I give very high amount, up to 4 grams. It's my first choice for pregnancy as well as lactation. Remember, there is no study in lactation. Still, we should take them as the pregnant people. And on top of that, I also use a combination with PPIs. And when we look at the acid packet and PPIs, we know that this is one of the effects of PPIs. PPIs also produce a smaller size of acid packet. Remember, PPIs do not change the number of reflux episodes. They just change the nature. The patient still has the same amount of reflux episodes, but not such a low pH. Weak acid reflux or non-acid reflux. How about this acid packet and the alginate? This is a study from Peter Kahila's group. You see, when I have a pH probe, if I make a pull through from stomach, this is the meal, why pH is 6. When I come here, pH drops to 3. This is the acid packet package. When I go to the esophagus, still it's high. Okay, this is very typical thing. You put a pH probe and pull it. When you give alginate, you abolish the acid packet. It comes top of the acid packet and push it down. Also, alginase decrease the acid packet to the deeper layers, deeper parts of the stomach. Here you see alginate press the acid packet about 10 centimeters away from the esophagogastric junction, which is important for us. And there are other studies showing that alginate also colocalize with the in patients with hiatal hernia on just scintigraphic study. You see there, this is the alginate coming now. Yellow is the acid. You see the colocalization of two medications together. I'm sorry, medication with acid. If we use add-on therapy a lot. PPI plus alginate, when we combine those two, this is a study from Japan, there is a much more significant effect with the combination of PPI plus alginate. Where do I use alginate? Mild or moderate cases as monotherapy. Combination of with PPI in with severe cases, chronic cough and LPR. I always combine in such group, as well as pregnancy and lactation, as I mentioned, and PPI refractory patients. How about the PPI inefficacy? We have a problem. Dimitri and me and other five countries in the world, we just finished a study. We just evaluated the PPI ineffectiveness problem. According to this study, I think it's a little bit exaggerated, but anyhow, about 45% of patients, their heartburn, and 55% of their regurgitation do not respond to PPI. I don't think the real world is that bad, but at least one third of our patients doesn't respond to PPI. In that case, it's good to put them on alginate. And let me go with this algorithm. I wanted to give the Dimitri time to also talk about his studies about alginate. This is the Turkish reflux guidelines. We try to make it as simple as possible. If we have a patient with typical symptoms, heartburn and regurgitation. If it's mild, put the patient, alginate. I'm not a fan of antacid. I never use antacid by my side. I don't believe them. Alginate, low dose of PPI, or maybe H2 blockers. I don't use H2 blockers because I know about 50% of patients will be resistant to the effect of H2 blockers. This is why I prefer alginate or PPI low dose in such patient. If my patient has moderate or severe symptoms, in that case, I start with single dose of PPI in the morning. If they don't respond, then I go to double. Double means half an hour before the dinner. And then I look at the results. What happened? Can I stop the PPI? If I can stop it, bah, what a lovely word. Otherwise, I try to go with the minimum effective dose. Okay, this is one approach. If there is an alarm symptom, or if your patient is older than 50 years old, has symptoms longer than 5 years, and PPI unresponsive, then go with the endoscopy. Only once, if there is no Barrett, please never, never repeat the endoscopy. One is enough. And according to the findings, if it's either it's a NERD or erosive esophagitis. If erosive esophagitis, a severe one, esophagitis C or D, go with double. A or B, go with single dose of PPI. And try to stop it again, if you can. But if your patient does not respond to PPI, or recur, very common, then send to the experts. Then we perform motility and pH impedance. pH by itself is a dead methodology. We don't use it anymore. But impedance pH is expensive though. We don't use the conventional manometry anymore. We use high resolution manometry, but it is very expensive. One catheter costs 25,000 euro. But we have many different modalities, new diagnostic modalities, and it gives us different approaches. And according to those, either I have an acid reflux disease, okay, or I have a weak acid reflux disease, or as I mentioned, hypersensitive esophagus or functional heartburn, whatever. Then what I do, I play with the medications. I use a lot of add-on therapy, PPI and alginate. Sometimes I add, as I mentioned, prokinetics or antidepressants, according to the patient situation. And if they don't want the surgery, I keep them on PPI until the end of their life. The question, are those dangerous PPIs? According to Turkish guidelines, we evaluate the whole data. Only four groups of risk really significant. Which one has the highest value for risk ratio? What do you think? Pneumonia, fractures? No. spontaneous bacterial peritonitis. This is the highest risk. Odds ratio is 3.5. Be careful with your cirrhosis patients. Don't put them for the unnecessary PPI, please. Others, I don't care. There is no significant risk. But every week, I see a new publication. PPIs is a risk for chronic renal failure. Ah! PPI is a risk for Alzheimer's and dementia. PPI is a risk for myocardial infarction, recently gastric cancer. Very recently, you know, I'm expecting for whatever, think about all the details. Are those important? The problem, those are all retrospective data. Odds ratios are somewhere around 1.2 to 1.5, very small. And those population-based studies perform on the patients with many, many comorbidities. It's very difficult to, you know, to claim that PPIs are harmful. But anyway, be careful. This is an interesting topic. In last year in United European GI Week, I actually talked about that. And when they gave me this talk, I thought, I have never and ever see a slide how to stop PPI. We always talk about how to initiate the therapy. We never talk about how to stop it. Try to stop it, step down and reach the lowest effective dose and continue therapy. Switch to intermittent dose. If you can do, go with the on-demand therapy. Western countries hate that, but I'm a believer that. If I cannot cure the patient, then I can go with the on-demand therapy. Who cares? This is a symptomatic therapy, actually. Okay? This is, and if you can, go to the less harmful medication, such as alginate. This is another option. Or go with, generally, I give my patient a fast-acting PPI and alginate, and I tell my patient, take whatever you want to take as an on-demand therapy. And it has been shown that if you switch to alginate, actually it's more cost-effective in such patients. Thank you very much for listening to me. This is the our reflux group. We are working with general surgery, psychiatry. Wow, those guys are very important psychiatrists, pulmonary medicine, ENTs, and as well as the general surgeons. And thanks for listening.
Thank you so much, Serhat. We have a few minutes for my presentation. Пожалуйста, запустите.
15 minutes, I left.
Уважаемые коллеги, ну вот мы обсудили проблему.
Dear colleagues, we discussed the issue of acid pocket, and it is quite clear that if the prevailing symptom is regurgitation, PPI are not as effective as alginates. But the question arises whether it is an alternative strategy or it can be combined, and what is better in what situations. Of course, we know all about the reflux disease, and we know that reflux is a trigger, but modulate our clearance of the esophagus and sensitivity of esophagus. Of course, we know what is an acid pocket, what it is caused by. It is very important to know the content of the acid pocket. You see that each of us has an acid pocket after 40 minutes after food. And this acid pocket is the source of reflux. We understand that reflux arises when the lower LEC is ineffective. Super sensitivity of the phagus. Serhat spoke about it. It is a very important issue, and most of patients, of course, have anxiety, hypersensitivity as moderators of the reflux. If we speak at ROM4 that Serhat doesn't like, we understand that there is a combination of reflux and acid effect with pepsin and acids, plus super sensitivity of the esophagus, and depending on what is prevailing, we understand that there are situations of erosive esophagitis. where there are different combinations of supersensitivity and reflux. I won't stop on diagnostics of impedance. pH measurement is very helpful here, and we may use alginate also as a diagnostic criterion for GERD, because we can diagnose GERD because the reason of the heartburn was reflux. As to the speed of the heartburn solution, it is better of all to use alginate and antacid. Nevertheless, the best control of heartburn is ensured by PPI. Esomeprazole has an advantage over other drugs, but if we speak about the situation of the first day of therapy, it's better to combine PPI and alginate. We studied it. So these are the first days when one group was pontoprazole therapy, pontoprazole alginate therapy. We see the difference in the first case. In the second group, most patients had no heartburn on the second day. We see a dramatic reduction of the expressed symptom of those patients who had a combined therapy. So we see the best improvement in the group of the combined therapy. These data were confirmed by foreign trials, and Sirhat spoke about the advantages of combined therapy. Of course, there are cases where we can use monotherapy by alginates if we cannot use PPI, say in pregnant women, for example. As to the efficacy of healing, it is approximately the same, but there are very severe situations of esophagitis E, C, and D. And in this case, esomeprazole has an advantage. The meta-analysis of 2006 showed that esomeprazole is effective for severe cases. And today we had a discussion between the surgeon and the therapist about how to treat a patient surgically or by PPI. If it is a real reflux disease, then the LOTUS trial shows that fund application and long therapy by esomeprazole is similar as to the removal of inflammatory process. That's why we may conclude that heartburn decreases the quality of life, and it is, but it may be of a reflex character and non-reflex character, and IPP and alginates won't help. Then, in this case, the help of psychiatrist is required. PPI are most effective for the prevention of heartburn, but it may stay in the first day of therapy. And if we speak about reflux esophagitis, so that IPP are most effective to treat and maintain the remission of reflux esophagitis. Thank you very much. So I tried to make it for 7 minutes. Thank you very much for your attention. And now we give the audience to this room to the next symposium. Thank you.